Yesterday we had a very interesting conversation, and I was talking about the economy of Ghana generally, and I said that the economy of Ghana has recorded impressive growth over the last 10 years. This is underpinned by high commodity prices. You may be aware that Ghana is one of the largest producers of cocoa, gold. And recently, we've also started exporting crude oil. Now, on the average, we recorded growth of 8% per annum, which is one of the highest in sub-Saharan Africa. And I was saying that the growth is underpinned by the kind of environment, economic environment that we have crafted. We have sound political history, impressive political history. Democratic governance has been entrenched. We have an impressive democratic history. You may be aware that over the last 24 years, we have had a very stable democratic system. We transferred power from one party to the other without any routes, as it happens in other African countries. Recently, in 2012, the election results ended in the Supreme Court, and we're happy that last week the final judgment was given, where the sitting president has been confirmed as duly elected by the electorate. And we are happy. The opposition congratulated the president, and everybody, there's so much peace. And this is what is underpinning most of the developmental activities that we are experiencing in the country. On the other reforms that we have done reforms in both the monetary and financial sectors, as well as the public financial sector management. On the monetary sector, the central bank has been in the forefront of the major reforms. The first thing we did was to amend the Bank of Ghana Act to grant operational independence to the central bank in the conduct of monetary policy. This is very, very important because monetary policy is a very technical thing, and politicians should not meddle in monetary policy affairs. Hence, the need for the central bank to be insulated from the political forces, and that is why we amended the act. So since 2002, the central bank has operational independence to formulate and implement monetary policy without reference to the government authorities. Apart from that, we adopted what we call inflation targeting regime. And the inflation targeting regime is a very comprehensive system of monetary policy formulation and implementation. We went through a number of systems in the past. First, administered system of monetary policy. We also targeted monetary aggregates. But over time, because of the reforms that we have undertaken, we realized that the demand for money function is no longer stable. Therefore, you can no longer be targeting monetary aggregates and expect to see the desired result. Hence, the shift to inflation targeting. The inflation targeting, as I said, is very comprehensive. It starts, first of all, with the determination of a target, inflation target, which we do jointly with government. We look at other models and determine where we'll be in the future. Now, having determined the target, the central bank uses its key monetary instrument, which is interest rate, to steer inflation towards the target at all times. And in the sessions of the Monetary Policy Committee, what we do is to analyze data from various sectors of the economy, including the fiscal performance and the fiscal outlook. We also look at how money is trending. Even though we are not targeting money, but we still think that money is still important in an economy because that's what creates the demand. And excess demand can feed into prices and hence high inflation. We also look at the real sector. What is the real sector saying, or real sector operators? What are they saying? We do surveys to look at the consumers, what they are saying, what businesses are saying, and what the financial institutions are saying about their expectations of inflation. Indeed, all that we are trying to do is to ensure that inflation is properly anchored within the economy. Bernanke will tell you that, you have stability when people are setting prices and they do not consider inflation. Once they do that, then you can say that you have reasonable stability within the economy. Apart from that, we also look at the external sector. How are commodity prices doing? What is the output even from your country perspective? Right now, you look at the commodity price development and some are softening. For example, gold price is on a decline. This is one of our major export commodities. And therefore, you should be able to project the effect of this on your balance of payments, on your current account development, and hence, international reserves. So we look at all this, and indeed, one other thing that we do is to, because inflation GDP numbers are released with a lag, we developed a model that helps us to gauge the tempo of economic activity. Because at the end of the day, we are not only targeting inflation, but we also look at GDP development. And therefore, we develop an index we call composite index of economic activity. And at each of the sections, we collect data, feed into this model, and it gives us an idea as to the direction of economic activity, whether economic activity are on the upscale or on the decline or is stable. So at the end of the day, we are able to gauge the risks to output vis-a-vis the risk to inflation. And the risk to inflation is gauged when we bring all these assessments together, the fiscal assessment, the monetary assessment, the external sector, and the real sector. And we then do a ranking of this risk. And at the end of the day, wherever the risk is weighted, heavily weighted, then we adjust our monetary policy instrument, that is the interest rate, so that we steer inflation back onto the central path, so that at the end of the day, we will be able to achieve the target that we have mutually agreed with government.